We've told you about PFAS contamination in groundwater in the past, but you don't have to drink PFAS to be exposed to it.
For our next story, we teamed up with Type Investigations, Consumer Reports, The Guardian, and journalist Tom Perkins. While reporting on PFAS, he learned a lot about the many things PFAS has been used for, and he began to get personally concerned.
The more I reported on the issue and the more I learned what products they're in, I started to look around my apartment and go, my God, there are dozens of things in here that are sometimes made with the chemicals. Am I getting a slow drip of poison from these things?
And it's not just me. My cat Ling Ling probably encounters a lot of the same chemicals that I do, and she only weighs about 9 pounds. We're in Hamtramck, a small city surrounded by Detroit, and the problem is PFAS, a family of chemicals known for their water and stain repellent qualities that are used in everything from waterproof shoes, to clothing, to bike chain lube, even food packaging. I wanted to know how much PFAS Ling Ling and I are getting into our bodies and our daily lives, so I made a plan.
What we're gonna do is test a bunch of different products around my house that are sometimes made with the chemicals and see if they have PFAS in them. One of the main ways people ingest the chemicals is through their water. And we're gonna test the tap water as well and then get my blood checked out.
And Ling Ling's getting her blood checked too.
Industry has just introduced chemical after chemical and they don't provide that information to the public. So It's impossible for scientists to keep up with what's actually being used.
Yeah. Erica Schrader is the science director of the Seattle-based advocacy group Toxic Free Future.
You know, some unexpected chemicals have been found in people recently. There was a compound that was found in the river water in North Carolina. And then after that, they tested residents and found in 98% of the residents. So it was a previously unheard of chemical that almost everybody in that area was being exposed to.
The wide application of these chemicals means that you can't pinpoint the particular use that's led to your exposure very easily.
Carla Ng is a PFAS researcher at the University of Pittsburgh who models the chemicals' bioaccumulation in humans and wildlife.
There are thousands of potential products that use these chemicals, and therefore you may be exposed via your food, via your sports equipment, via your carpets, through your electronic equipment. And so pinpointing the one particular chemical that's in your blood, knowing exactly where that came from, becomes that much more difficult.
I shipped a couple dozen household items to a lab at the University of Notre Dame. There's advanced PFAS research going on there, led by Professor Graham Peasley.
Food packaging is a big one, parchment paper, different food wrappers from restaurants around Detroit. That's one of the main routes of exposure.
You know, I want to remind you that a lot of our concern about the use on food packaging is what happens before it comes to the consumer and after it comes to the consumer, because we see quite a bit of pollution in the production phase. And then after you dispose of it, you know, depending on where you live and what the facilities are, it could go to a landfill, incinerator, or compost. And landfills are very major sources of PFAS contamination.
It's been a couple months and I've now got the results for the items that I sent out to be tested for PFAS. I was worried that there might be Scotchgard on the pre-owned mid-century couch that Ling Ling and I spend a lot of time on. No sign of PFAS there, but it's in other things, things that many might not think of.
They found it in my dental floss. There isn't a lot of research out there on whether that's a big route of exposure.
I use Oral-B Glide, made by Procter & Gamble. A company spokeswoman told me they don't use PFAS in floss, and that's where the issue gets tricky. There are literally thousands of PFAS chemicals, and sometimes disputes arise over which chemicals are PFAS and which chemicals are not. The tests we did show high levels of fluorine in my floss, and scientists agree there's even a peer-reviewed study that high levels of fluorine indicate high levels of one of the PFAS compounds. Turned out my tap water is clean, but then the blood work came in.
Both are not good. They found 4 compounds in my blood and 3 compounds in Ling Ling's blood at levels that are higher than US medians for most of the chemicals. One of the compounds in Ling Ling's blood is about 13 times the median for a US adult. She's a 9-pound cat. It's a little bit scary.
You had a chance to look at the test results?
I sure did. They're very interesting. The levels that the lab found in your body were similar to what's seen across the country in men. So it doesn't look like you have any especially high exposures from, say, your drinking water. But it does show that you have these levels of chemicals like PFAS that have been associated with a number of different health concerns. You know, they range from cancer to effects on the immune system.
One way PFAS enters our systems is simple. As household items slowly turn to dust, the PFAS drifts along with it.
I mean, if I had to just hazard a guess, I'd probably say it's going to be a combination of the diet and the dust.
Yeah.
Both of you.
Yeah.
You know, if you're eating fish, you're getting some of these chemicals in your food. We also find that they build up in our house dust. And so all people are exposed to house dust. Mm. If you're a toddler or a cat, then you spend a lot more time kind of interacting with house dust. Mm-hmm. And, you know, cats, of course, also have the behavior that they're licking their fur.
Right. Another thing I learned with PFAS, blood tests don't tell you everything.
What we find with some of these compounds is that they're actually building up in different parts of our bodies. Like there's one that's been found at higher levels in the lungs.
Are you saying that might not necessarily then be detected in a blood test if it's like building up in a different part of the body?
Exactly, yeah.
Oh, wow. That's another frightening layer to add to this.
Well, that's me. What about my cat? I mean, what about Ling Ling? Like, she's up in the 99th percentile.
Yeah. So the half-lives are long for some of these chemicals, but if you eliminate the exposures, those concentrations will go down, right? They're not going to go down very fast, but they do go down.
I found some studies on cats. Cats have been studied for PFAS. Mm-hmm. And so I just had the total PFAS levels from one study that was done in California. They did two time frames. One was 2008 to 2010, and then one was 2012 to 2013. Mm-hmm. Total PFAS they had in the earlier time frame was 15.8. So, and then in the latter time frame it was 8.1. That was the mean level. So she is above average for cats.
Uh-huh. Wow.
California cats.
Yeah, California cats.
Michigan cats may have more PFAS.
Industry has been replacing the PFAS in their products with newer versions of the chemicals that they claim are safer, though Ng and others' research are finding that they aren't. Now there are so many different kinds of PFAS and blood testing can only find some of them, so it likely have much higher levels than the testing revealed. Got all this good information, but man, it just raised more questions than it answered, and some of these questions are impossible to answer, and that's just like what's so frustrating about it.
For the most part now, we look outside, the sky looks more or less blue. We turn on our water and the water tastes fine, but we know that that's not always the case. And many of the things we're starting to learn now about chemical impacts on humans are about these low concentration chronic impacts that are not going to make you fall over dead. They're not going to make you pass out, if you breathe the air. But we know that there's a cost over a long period of time. So if we look at the burden of disease in the population, chronic disease is going up. It's something that really stresses our medical system, and it's something that is definitely affected by our increased exposure to environmental chemicals.
Should I be worried? I guess let me just ask you that.
I mean, I'm not an anxious kind of person. I'm not going to tell you it should keep you up at night. I mean, you had levels that are very typical for Americans. Unfortunately, we do see that, typical levels can be tied to certain health issues like, reduced immunity. Mm-hmm. So that is definitely a concern. What you can do about that is, take actions to reduce the use of PFAS in your home and support policies that stop the use of products. We don't keep getting it in our homes.
At Great Lakes Now, we aim to cover the Great Lakes region and the people who live here, like you. Please follow us on social media, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and sign up for our newsletter at greatlakesnow.org.